Welcome to the Black Parade. What?
What's this? Welcome to 155, a podcast about punk songs. I feel like we haven't said that in a long time, and
yeah,
maybe it behooves us.
Does our show make sense to anyone? Did anyone get into it last week and love it?
They're like, oh, this is a podcast for me. I see it's like sort of about the song, but it's absolutely not. And I don't know. These guys are so cool and nice. I'm going to keep listening. So this is 155.
In the
podcast.
In the Mama,
we haven't said that in a long time.
In the Mama Na 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 episode, there's a moment.
Yes.
I think after I was shaming Democracy Now! Guests for having acid reflux voice, moments after that, I started coughing. And, you know, we're still recording the same week as that episode for various reasons. But guess
that
what?
That sounds like really nefarious for various reasons.
I was trying to.
But yeah, Josiah, how's your cough, dog?
It was nothing to be alarmed about, and I'll continue volunteering at the old folks' home where I volunteer.
It's so good. You shouldn't let anything stop your good, important work.
I'm the local kissing boy at the residential
love to
care
kiss.
Home.
I
did finally get coronavirus, and I'm just.
Hey, did you get it from kissing? Like, was this?
I have genuinely no idea how I got it, but I think I seriously think that I got it from maybe Smule or from saying Mama Nana so many times. Either something about the last couple of weeks, we've invited some kind of curse onto ourselves. There's no question.
It does. It does make sense that, in particular, the video of Smule's founder with his, like, you know, spooky imp behind him perhaps could have transmitted something through the computer directly to your respiratory system. And I like that you are hedging, though, because of when we were recording, on the off chance that you are still able to. You don't want any NAISH members to see you out in the wild before hearing this episode and think you were being irresponsible.
Exactly.
Why the timeline is important.
Whenever you see me unmasked in public, just assume that this was recorded about, you know, whatever, 12 days before.
14 days, yeah, whatever the, yeah, exactly.
Whatever it was, you know, this is, we're
recording
this in
2019. So how are your lungs, man? How are you doing? Because the last episode had, like, I'm getting sick energy from you, but that's sometimes just what happens when you podcast too much.
I know. I feel like shit, actually. And also we had our fridge broke like 3 weeks ago, and that took forever to get dealt with. But we have a new fridge also, so that's good. But I'm not allowed to buy any groceries for it, so it's great.
Did you like at some point, you know, hit like a wizened old crone with your car?
I think so. Like, probably some kind of like old, some old witch or something.
That's
maybe
what I'm thinking.
She covered a song and I mocked it too much. On Smule. It must be Smule. It's Smule's fault.
It is Smule. You've been Smule hexed. The Smulers
focused
all of their dark energy on you.
Let's just get through this fucking episode and
let's
get through this
join
month of
the
MCRch.
Black Parade.
Well, first we gotta do this. It's punk news. It's the news, but it's freaking punk. I need to use my sick voice to kind of sound like
the
Gen X lady who introduces Lithium on SiriusXM. You're listening.
Oh, I haven't listened to Lithium in a long time.
She's like, you're listening to Lithium, two coasts of alternative culture. Like, she just so deeply doesn't give a fuck that it's almost like I don't think she should even have this job anymore.
Wow,
she's checked out. She's gone too far down the aloof Gen X-ness.
I was hoping that you might lean into like a classic snotty pop punk voice. Of course, again, we are recording this. You are hearing this 1 week into culture being shifted by the arrival of MGK's mainstream sellout. But
yeah,
pop punk is back, and you've got the voice to prove it.
That's true. And the swag.
So what's your, you want to go first?
I'll go first. Mine kind of plays into the whole swaggy pop punk revival. I just cannot believe this. This was posted by this guy, Marco Puss.
You sound so sick.
I know. It's fun. And why don't we get sick days on this show? It's crazy.
Yeah, you know, it's never happened. So who is...
There's
who
no
is,
PTO on this fucking podcast.
Who's Mark...
Mark Opus. I don't know.
Mr. Marks.
Yeah. I was trying to think. That's probably been his display name before. Hey, Mr. Marks Hoppus. Or maybe he'll do it like in a year. Once like the last three remaining people who have seen Mr. Holland's Opus have died off, then he'll reference it. Anyways, he shared this and was like, oh my God, I'm honored. Have I ever been cool though? And it's like, so it's a bunch of people who seem to be like YouTube haircut guys. Kellen Quinn and 408 and Magnolia Park, I guess is who it is. They have this new song called Mark Hoppus. And it really makes me never want to talk about Blink-182 ever again in my life.
I've got the video playing, and yeah, this is definitely... And I just want to say, there already was featuring Mark Hoppus by Hot Mulligan, which is a sick tune.
Isn't Hot Mulligan...
And that's like a funny way to
so
do it.
So isn't Hot Mulligan like one of those bands that's like... You know like how there's like this whole world of DIY Twitter where there's all these bands?
Yeah, I'm too old to understand what Hot Mulligan's deal is.
I think like, Hot Mulligan is part of that world where it's like there's endless bands that have 4,000 followers on Twitter... And they all have managers, and they're all friends with each other, but they all hate each other. Is Hot Mulligan in that kind of world of DIY?
I think yeah. That's my impression. And there's like constant, it seems like there's constant drama. I feel like.
There's so much drama, and they all have so many managers, all these DIY bands. It's
yeah,
crazy.
Every member of these bands has a manager.
That's very Blink of them, I guess. But yeah, so that's what I think. That was kind of in the, I guess, the quote-unquote DIY underground then when Hot Mulligan did it. but now it's moved up to the ranks, to this realm. So this, you've already seen some of the video. Yeah, there's lots of Blink references in here. The music is just unbelievable. Mark Hoppus.
Oh, this is not what I expected this to sound like, but I guess... I shouldn't be surprised. But the visuals are very, like, pop punk. I thought this was going to sound much more like Mainstream Sellout by Machine Gun Kelly. How does this sound? Okay, so they're, like, doing the...
so
what's my age thing of, like, running naked through the city, but they're all, like, the main guy is, like, too jacked. Like, you realize, like, obviously, like, Blink were, like, good-looking dudes, but they did sort of have, like... relatively normal guy, like normal skinny guy bodies, but like the main dude like definitely works out. Like he's got like real traps going.
Sam's really just going straight for the body shaming.
Look how strong this guy's back is.
Straight for the
no, yeah. I think that people who spend that much time looking good should not be allowed to be naked in public. Like keep it to yourself and those you care about.
He also looks like he's like 45. Like he looks like
like that close up. I was like, how fucking old is this man?
But we need to
think the worst thing is he's definitely 10 years younger than us.
Kellen Quinn, Mark Hoppus, lyrics.
One day I'll be cool like Mark Hoppus.
Yeah, that, and there's something about punk rock shit. There's always someone there's always someone who comes in with like a CGI voice. This is so fucked.
This is insane.
I'm glad everyone's having fun. I'm glad I'm going to be dead soon.
Just so I'm clear, who are these all? So there's like kind of seemingly three sets of people. There's like the four-person band.
408.
Like two guys.
Kellen Quinn and Magnolia Park. I already told you.
Sorry. I thought they were all individually. I thought every guy in this band was an influencer with their own manager.
I know. I'm just joking. I actually have no clue. 408, I guess, is the band whose song this is.
The one guy in the band looks so much like one of the dudes in the Funny Games like remake.
It really
is unsettling.
I know what you're talking about.
Like, so,
I think
what's
it's
this
like,
guy up to?
They're like punk rock shit. I wish that I was cool like Mark Hoppus. You be on my punk rock shit. Blame it on my youth and that's toxic rock shit. So that's my punk news.
That is great. That is great A Punk news.
Well, the actual lyrics are, I think, on the video. I just need to quickly see if there's anything important in here. One day I'll be I lost it switching up on me. That's toxic. One day I'll be cool like Mark Hoppus. Blame it on my youth, like punk rock shit. All the small things keep running through my head like the thought of you leaving me. That's so clever, dude.
Wow. Okay.
No one liked me at 23. Wasn't fair between you and me. Guess we got to change our views and stop playing make-believe. That's cool. Yeah, shout out to punk rock shit.
Yeah, I mean, I love punk rock shit. That's really punk news is sort of one step up from punk rock shit for sure. So there's we definitely have a kinship there.
Well, the journalists are getting deep into the punk rock shit before they can get that punk rock news.
So my punk news also comes from the world of Blink 182. I mean, of course, Travis Barker, you know, now the empresario of all popular music in the world. But still, you know, despite all of his accolades, everything he's doing for the scene, being forced to defend himself to haters. What is this? I mean,
come on. I thought this was a family.
You know what, this ain't a scene. It's a goddamn arms race. Josiah, because according to iHeartRadio Music News, this is of course where I get, I'm surprised that this is not iHeartRadio Punk News.
Yeah, or iHeartPunk. what if there was something called iHeartPunk?
Yeah, this is, you should delete this part of the episode. You and I should talk about this after. Travis Barker, again, despite everything he's done for the culture, Travis Barker defends Kourtney Kardashian wearing Cannibal Corpse shirt. Mm. And so it sounds like, there's another instance, because this has happened already. This is sort of part of a grand tradition of gatekeeping and calling people out for being posers, in particular
so dope.
From the What's a Kardashian
gatekeeping is
crowd.
So dope. Oh, that's not the point you're trying to make.
Is.
You know what's funny about this, though? Even though I agree we should always be sourcing our news from iHeartRadio, this is actually an aggregation from Revolver magazine. And this interview was done by none other than I Was There featured guest on Patreon,
shit.
Greg Adams. So, and I think...
Because punk is a community.
I think Greg Adams has that news bite brain from working at Exclaim for so long. He knew how to get the little nug that everyone was going to run with. Because this is like literally trending everywhere.
Yeah, this was a real tasty nug. So, of course, we all remember last year when noted cool guy Chris Barnes... called out Travis Barker and Kourtney Kardashian when K-Car, I don't know what the nickname is,
that's good.
was snapped wearing a Cannibal Corpse shirt. And he talked some shit, and it looks like to Greg Adams, friend of the pod, T-Barks is fired back in an interview about his work with Horror. To speak on that, which is an insane way to start a sentence, this is the quote, to speak on that.
That's so tight.
Who fucking starts talking like
so
that?
That's so great. That's like when Jesus
as
starts
regards,
his quote by saying, I tell you the truth. That's kind of, you're like, damn, okay, I'm listening. Also,
okay.
You call this band Horror?
Honestly,
I thought they were called Ho 99 09.
To speak on that, that's the lamest shit ever, he said bluntly. Obviously, my fiance doesn't listen to Cannibal Corpse, but I do. I grew up loving them. For someone to mention that in a negative light, fucking lame, you know? And I want to point out that I'm putting the swears in, but of course the good
people
at iHeartRadio Music News have bleeped them out. But I'm assuming he said fuck here. She's wearing it because she's cold. She's not claiming she knows every song, but I do. I bought every album and I learned how to play every album. And then it goes on. I feel like I want to read this whole thing. I grew up a punk rock kid, which is, of course, what you say when you grew up a punk rock kid. Mm-hmm. But everything with punk rock, I'm more punk than you. Just fuck all that. Be stoked that people are into music. Music is beautiful. It changes people's lives. It creates the best memories. Just celebrate it, you know? He added. Okay, but yeah, I have a gang of Cannibal Corpse t-shirts. I still love them. I have a gang of King Diamond t-shirts and Rare Slayer shirts because I fucking love those bands. I grew up on them, even though I'm, you know, whatever the world wants to view me as. Oh, that's Blink-182's drummer. Actually, that guy was playing in a garage with a bunch of speed metal kids listening to DRI and SOD, enjoying every fucking minute of it.
I clicked through to the original source, and it's you're right. He was saying the F word that many times. kind of
this. Did he? That's, well, kind of, Travis, you know, you're a role model. Maybe clean up the language a little bit.
I mean, I have so many thoughts and questions. I guess the first...
Tell me all your thoughts.
I guess the very first thing is, did he mean, like, does he actually literally mean cold? Or is he using some kind of vernacular to call her cool? Or
right. That's,
did he say cool? And I mean, I'm sure Greg's a great transcriber, and I'm sure he didn't fuck it up. I'm sure he said cold, but what did he mean by that? Like,
right, like, she's always cold. I always have to give her my shirts.
It's like you're giving her like a rare, like, $900 vintage t-shirt because she's cold. Isn't there something? Don't you have some like Barker Wellness fucking Gildan crewnecks in a box somewhere that no one wants? So you can just give her that. Like, that's kind
of weird. I just feel like this is also like they're all vegan or whatever, right?
Yeah.
Like, I feel like this is, you know, like when you're that skinny, it's just, again, to just bring back body shaming. Really, I'm just like, I'm not surprised. He doesn't look healthy.
You don't put on a t-shirt when you're cold. Like, that doesn't make any sense.
But they live in California. So here's the thing. I'm thinking mostly they're in like just, you know, I feel like in every photo, they tend to be very scantily clad. And so if it's like, you know, mid-20s.
Sam is really taking a turn this week.
Listen, I've just decided to let all my realist opinions ride here.
I mean, part of my goal this week is to make you miss a flight, I think. But at the same time, to stay on this a little bit longer.
We're in a classic time crunch. We are in a time crunch. That's real.
Yeah, and mine is literally facing the end of my life. yeah. I also was just wondering, why does he keep referring to his collection of teachers as a gang? That's so peculiar to me. A gang of Cannibal Corpse t-shirts? What?
Is that a transplants kind of, you know, like cholo kind of posing lifestyle? You know what I mean? Like, just really trying to be of the streets.
Right. But he doesn't list them all as the same gang. Like, each band is its own gang. So no, do they ever have rivalries?
He has to keep them separated.
Oh, shit.
No gang colors allowed. Like,
I also just think it's kind of, I guess my final thought is like, it feels different, even though obviously I think this is a great quote and I love it. And I actually think it's just, truthfully, I think this is like the best thing that Travis has said out loud probably ever in his life. It's so good to just be like, shut the fuck up. Who cares, you nerd? I love these bands. Like, that's sick. But at the same time, it feels different when it's like not just some random like metalhead mouth breather calling you out, but it's actually like the guy from the band. Like, that,
yeah,
to
totally.
Me, like, it's weird to still be like, I fucking love this band and I will for the rest of my life. But it's like the guy
I mean, you still love Godspeed, right? Godspeed basically like clowned you.
Well, yeah, that's kind of, I mean, that's a little different.
Is it?
I think so. I'm trying to think of a better example. Oh, I have one, but that's for the
it's for the DMs.
Yeah.
You know what? Last week's episode also, like, there's just like spicy DM tier.
There's so much. And it's all CanCon.
Wow. Oh, okay. That's interesting.
Yeah. So, I mean,
I didn't realize how much that hurt you.
Oh, yeah. That's the thing. So, like, I'm not, and I don't even mean that. I also am maybe trying to say that the critique of her wearing the shirt might have some more legitimacy in the sense that it's coming from the band.
Oh, interesting. Okay, so you really are coming up pro gatekeeper here.
I'm just saying there's so many layers to this juicy onion.
Lock the gates, right?
We need to get out of this section, I think, but...
I agree.
Black Parade. We all know about it. So we don't even need to talk about it because we don't have time.
Everyone knows and loves. This feels like this is so funny because doing like big Blink songs used to make me kind of nervous. But I actually think like this might be one of the biggest songs, like for some people anyway, who listens to this podcast. But like in general,
who listens to this podcast? And also
show yourself.
First of all, who listens? Second of all, who's listening and like just taking notes about all the things that they're annoyed by about it? Because I feel like that's also a thing, and that's kind of
funny, but that's
to
what
me.
The complaint department is for.
I know.
So true. Thank you for your attention to detail. I mean, let's you know, get into what everyone comes here for, which is our sort of personal hot take. Josiah, how do you feel about the song The Black Parade by the band My Chemical Romance?
This is the first one by this band that I think I remember seeing this music video on Much Music. I feel like at the dentist, but I feel like I've said that about other music videos. I just feel like I maybe used to only watch Much Music at the dentist all the time. And I feel like
my dentist just has CP24 on. I feel like you're going to a real cool rocker dentist.
Well, not anymore. I haven't been to the dentist in probably 20 years, but,
damn.
And that's a slight exaggeration.
And that's why we're so excited about the coalition government. Well, it's not a coalition government.
We don't even get sick days. Like, how am I supposed to? I also forgot to watch this and listen to it. So, but I do remember.
It is. So this was, the music video was named by MTV as like the best music video of the century.
Yeah, I remember being drawn to how epic it was. And
it's got Lucas Haas in it.
Yeah.
And it the costumes were designed by someone who, like,
I feel like Lucas Haas kind of like set the stage for Scoot McNairy to really shine, you know?
Like, no, I feel like
those guys never been in the same room.
There's a pre Lucas Haas, the guy, the even littler, sicker guy. is he in Road Trip or Euro Trip or whatever? His name is like JP. What's his fucking name?
I don't know what you're talking
about.
Dude,
I know who I'm talking about. Little guy. Little 90s actor guy. I'm going to get it.
Euro Trip cast here.
Oh, yes. Euro Trip, maybe not Road Trip. You know, JP Scoots or something is like his name.
No, Scoot McNairy.
Okay, look, I'll figure this out. People are yelling at their television right now, screaming.
All you said is little guy.
I guarantee you right now that at the very least, a friend of the pod, Justin Taylor, knows what I'm talking about.
If someone who's not Justin knows who Sam's talking about, okay, you get a prize.
And his name is like letter deducting kind of thing. Okay. You know,
you get a small, you get a small but real prize if you can guess it without any more clues. Okay. What? Anyways, I remember seeing this video at my hip alternative dentist that was by the McDonald's in downtown Abbotsford, and I remember thinking it was like really epic, but kind of not wanting to like it because it also is corny as hell. And then I think I started liking it again. Just straight up liking it because it's so anthemic. And now I think MCRch has me leaning towards being like, I need to chill on this band a little bit. I'm kind of like, it's all just a bit much. Maybe it's the COVID speaking, but I'm just like, it's all just a bit much, you guys.
You're just sort of overloaded. Okay, listen, it's like how there's like Thomas Jane and then there's also Aaron Eckhart. It's like there's Lucas Haas and there's this other, like there's always just two of these fucking guys.
Someone will get it. Someone will get it. It's fine.
Oh,
what's your thoughts on Welcome to the...
So, wait, I remember when I like...
Is the song called The Black Parade or Welcome to... And what's the...
Welcome to the Black Parade.
But the album's just called The Black Parade. That's the difference. Okay.
A little bit of a mixy Dixie there. So... I just love, like, because, okay, when I was kind of compiling some notes for this, I was like, truly, what do people come to this podcast for? Because
I know, we got like
you
being
like, I didn't listen to it.
We got some like fan of the band, like some like fan person on this week.
We have like,
there's gonna be like fans
the guests
here
this week. I'm gonna pull back the curtain a little bit. We typically do know who's the guest, and so a little bit of a spoiler here. Cover your ears if you don't want to know this. The guest that we have this week has literally been dubbed the patron saint of the MCR fandom. This is like the king fan of MCR. And
listen, folks, if you're here for the fan, I mean, just check out the time code in the description.
That's a really good conversation.
I was gonna pretend to be all serious this week and be all like, oh yes, but I can't fucking do it.
You can't do it. So I distinctly remember like this record obviously like blew up. I wasn't into the other stuff, although like through the journey of MCRch I've developed like a much more sincere appreciation for it. And I remember like not kind of getting the big deal about Black Parade, because it felt like this was like such a big fucking moment, this record. And I also, at the time, was like working at Exclaim, and you know, Cam Lindsay, I think I can call him up by name, who's an editor there. And
so many Exclaim drops this week.
There's just, they're Adams, the only people. Cam Lindsay. yeah, all the classics. And he, like, I trusted Cam's opinion, and he thought this was like a transcendent, like this was like the big record of the year. And like generally when like emo and punk stuff kind of crossed over to him, it was oftentimes like things that were like kind of good, like that was real. And I remember listening to it and just sort of not connecting with it, despite loving musical theater and sort of being into, I think, some of the more theatrical elements on the record, until I got to this song. And I was like, oh, fuck, like, I get it. And it, to me, it's sort of interesting that this is not, I always think like that this is how the record starts, because I don't listen to this record ever.
Oh, I mean, I just assumed it did, but I also didn't listen to it.
No, this is like track five, and it is like ostensibly the title track. It feels like the kind of thesis statement, and it's absolutely not, but it has this sort of like slow build grandiosity of what feels like a, like an album opener kind of statement, the framing device, the thing that we always kind of talk about. In that moment I was like, oh fuck, I get it. I fucking love this. Like, this song is so fucking good. And it uses the sort of this mixture of like theatrical grandiosity and like just like an innately, I think, quite sick pop punk song. And it melds them in this like really effective way that like I don't think other bands that were doing the same kind of like I think of, you know, Panic at the Disco and stuff, same like theatrical kind of pop punk bands, or a lot of what Fall Out Boy kind of started doing, where I was like, man, it doesn't really, whereas this like feels really organic and it doesn't feel campy or winking. Like, it feels really, really fucking,
yeah, that's true,
sincere in a way that like I actually like appreciate, because it's like, go, like, if you're gonna do it, fucking go for it.
I guess my question is, so, since you've heard the song and you've heard the album, I assume, which I haven't, apologies to all the fans listening, this was, it's free, you don't have to pay for this, so that's one thing. But like, does this song, yeah, does this
get
song,
what you pay for?
You know, to use music writer speak, does this song make the whole thing cohesive? Does this make sense of the entire album? If you, like, do you know what I'm trying to get at? Because I feel like it doesn't. I feel like my understanding of My Chemical Romance is that there's all these weird different ideas that feel so disjointed.
Yeah. So just by the way, like, real quick, I remembered the name of the actor. I'm not going to say it because I am interested. Ooh, in my...
Tell me.
Okay, I'm going to put it in. This is a G-chat tier. But, like, I literally feel like a weight lifted off my shoulders. I feel like I've been, like, running around like I needed to take a shit for the last, like, 20 minutes. And I just,
this,
like,
guy is nothing like Lucas.
Are you kidding me? They're the same. Scoot. They're the same guy.
No.
Not Scoot McNairy. I'm saying Lucas Haas. I think you're
Lucas
Scoot
Haas and Scoot McNairy. Okay. All right.
No, right. Lucas Haas and this guy are like a Thomas Jane, the other Thomas Jane kind of guy.
Okay.
What's his name? Fuck. Aaron Eckhart. So, listen, this song rocks, but I kind of agree with what you were saying, which is when I started putting together the research for it, I was like, okay, like every time you actually start reading about a concept album, you're like, I don't know about this, because the whole album, and look, I really recognize that, A, we're presumably, potentially speaking to like some hardcore fans of this band, but
yeah, each other,
having not yes, and all, as always, each other, having not sort of grown up with the, like a deep emotional connection to this, it's all about this is an album about the patient, and the patient dies of cancer and they live in the moment of their best memory, and it's this moment seeing the parade with their father, and so the whole thing is this like cancer death album. And I do think it's important to note that this song, apparently none of the songs on this album have any reference to grandmothers dying except for this one.
It does.
This does have a lot.
Wait,
yeah,
have
this,
we done
this,
all the, have we done a straight flush of grandmothers?
This is grandmarch. Yeah.
Oh my god, that's so crazy. Lock up your grandmothers.
Yeah, yeah, there is a line.
Because I'm going to be kissing all these grandmas and giving them COVID.
Yeah, you're good. The grandma kisser is logged on. There is a line in one of the verses that is, sometimes I get the feeling she's watching over me. And according to Genius, she might be the personification of death.
Grammy.
Or it could be a reference to Gerard and Mikey Way's grandmother. But according to songfacts.com, this is the only song. They swear this is it. After this, they're good. They've healed those wounds. And now they're, I guess, just waiting for other people that they know and love to die.
They should do more grandma songs, I think.
I mean, you know.
At the very least, they should, together, do, right? They should, like, cover Grandma Got Run Over by a Reindeer.
Yeah, that would be a nice little holiday classic from the boys would be great.
And here's what I was thinking about. I was thinking maybe the Black Parade started off as a protest, but then all these brands got involved. It got, like, way too corporate. And now there's cops wanting to march in the Black Parade, too. And it's like, you know, should we let them?
I actually debated, like, doing a whole, like, this week we're talking about Beyonce's Black Parade. And I opted not to. But just know that, well, now I've said it, so just, I mean, I basically did
so
it.
So just admit. Yeah,
just for the
good,
record.
This is a good.
That's a great joke.
We're having a
great bit.
Great time.
So reading about the, like, concept and how this song kind of, like, really sort of ties the concept together, as, like, someone who was not as intimate with this record, it's like a bit, you're like, but then I realized, like, a year before this is when Boys Night Out put out their album Trainwreck, which is also a, you know, kind of emo pop punk concept album based around the point of view of a character called the Patient.
Really?
And I thought that record was, like, fucking, I still think that record is, like, an unheralded masterpiece.
Never
like
heard it.
The genre.
Is this band?
It's fucking
one,
incredible.
Is there? Oh no. I thought their band name was all one word, but I guess not. I think I've maybe seen you talk about this before, but yeah, I've never.
Because I think this is, like, to me, this is, like, an all-time underrated album of this moment. Like, they should have been alternative press cover darlings. Like, it's the perfect mixture.
I think that's
of,
how,
like,
you feel about literally every screamo adjacent band from, like, small town Ontario.
Yes, 100%. I'm like, why don't more, you know, anything? Because I think, look at it, and I hope you feel the same way. I think that my taste is unassailable and correct at all times. So, like, I think that this Boys
Do I think
Night
that
Out
about
record,
your taste? Absolutely.
Yeah, I assume you do. Otherwise, how would we have been doing this podcast for so many years?
Yeah, a Canadian post-hardcore band called Boys Night Out. Probably one of the greatest things ever made.
I'm sure. Are you quoting one of my tweets or whatever? Thanks, Josiah. Picking up where you left off, it does rock. So it's interesting to me that, like, and I do think, I mean, look, there's no way that these were developed at the same time, but it, like, there was pretension in the air, maybe, in this kind of general scene. Because, like, Boys Night Out were also, like, a Warped Tour alternative press type band, going on the same tours in the same kind of general kind of cultural circles. And to have these two high concept, you know, emo, post-hardcore, screamo, alternative rock, pop rock, this is according to Wikipedia, albums come out within a year of each other with The Patient at the center of it.
That's
the Boys
so
Night Out
funny.
One is like, you know what's funny though? Because the Boys Night Out one is way more like informed by like horror movies. It's like about a guy who like kills his wife in his sleep and cuts off his own fucking hands and shit and starts killing like everyone that he knows.
What about his grandma?
And then, and the My Chemical Romance one is like, a nice boy dies of cancer. Like it is like, okay, that's, you know, like Boys Night Out is like more inspired by Henry Porter of a Serial Killer, and My Chemical Romance is inspired by like, I don't know, what's like a sad, you probably watch sad cancer movies. It's probably like some Criterion shit or whatever. The Fault in Our Stars.
Yeah, the famous Criterion film.
There's got to be some. Are there any like teen cancer romances in the Criterion collection?
I'm trying to think if I've watched a cancer movie recently. Oh, you know, well, this is a bit of a spoiler, but the worst person in the world.
Which one? Oh, does one of them get cancer?
No,
I'm not gonna. I think still you. Where she's running. I'm like, that looks great, and then I'll like look at the description of the movie. I'm like, I'm never gonna watch this.
Honestly, it's pretty damn good. It
is. I like you watched that, and I watched Cop Shop.
Propaganda. I watched Dog with Channing Tatum.
Oh, how was that?
Truly insane. Like it's like trying to be propaganda and trying to be anti-war at the same time. And then there's like this long section that's like a right wing Portlandia parody. It's insane.
Oh, cool. Mm-hmm. Love Chan. I can't wait to see The Lost City.
So are we going to talk about this song or?
Yeah, we are. So I think, did I send you, I feel like there are tons of super in-depth, like, fact-focused My Chemical Romance podcasts for you to go to learn about the song. I do want to talk about some of the sort of facts from this song, because I am loving songfacts.com was never any good for us, I think, on, you know, our judge episodes.
There's
but for
so many
for My Chemical Romance.
Yeah, there's many facts with this band.
A lot of facts here. So here's one that I thought you might be interested in. There could be some biblical imagery in this song. As the father tells the son that the parade is the savior of the broken, the beaten, and the damned. The son, the son
like
does not think
JC.
Himself. But sorry, I just really love, like, the son does not think himself worthy to redeem these people. This could be seen as a reference to God, Father, telling Moses, his son, he needs to be the savior of the Jewish people, the broken, beaten, and the damned, and lead them out of Egypt. At first, Moses does not think himself worthy to this task. So I know you didn't listen to the song before we recorded it, but based on your memory of it, when you heard it, did you think, ah, that's the story of Moses leading the
that's
Jewish
interesting
people,
that when we talk about a savior of the broken, the beaten, and the damned, it goes back. This person thinks of Moses, I guess. That sounds less Christian and more, you know, it depends on who you define as the Messiah, I guess. But
well, they didn't say the parade to be the Messiah of the broken, the beaten, and the damned. Like, is Jesus both a Messiah and a savior?
Yeah, I think so. Pretty much the same deal. So. Interesting kind of little theological turn in this songfacts.com entry.
Now, in the same entry, like, for some reason, this is the same entry.
Yeah, why is it the same entry?
I don't know. But also, what I love about this is some of these things are, like, full Wikipedia-style facts, and some of them are massively editorializing. Like, this is not quite to the standard of genius.com, which is why I love it. So in the same fact about Moses and God, the video doesn't cut corners. Like, oh, wow, they spared no expense. Showing the Black Parade marching to meet the patient who is, I fucking love this, who is played by Lucas Haas from the movie Mars Attacks. Like, is that Lucas Haas's best known role, would you say?
I don't know what I know him from. I can't think of it.
Well, I certainly, when I think of Lucas Haas, I think of Ramblin' Rose, in which he plays Buddy. Maybe,
what's that?
Maybe, I don't know. I'm just literally looking at
this. It's like, I just assumed that you'd... No, well, I guess, like, he's from Inception and The Revenant.
But I guess this would probably... I feel like this website does not have the feeling of something that was written after. Like, Zoolander, though? I guess
he was in 24? That's sick.
How has that come up so much lately?
Chloe! We've only got 47 minutes left!
So that's a good song fact. This is, of course, where we learn that... There's a little bit of grandmother in here. We also learned, we've talked a lot about ghosts. Ghosts are also a big part of this because they came up with the song at the Paramore Mansion. So you can really hear, you can really hear the ghosts in this.
Imagine if there was a Smule Mansion, a Smansion, if you will. That'd be so scary.
I think we talked about that, right? The idea of like Smule kind of TikTok houses or whatever.
Oh, right, we did. Yeah. See, I don't remember anything.
We've already, but I don't think you said Smansion that time, so you've improved on the bit for sure.
We keep saying it every week until it's perfect.
Yeah, just try to make it happen, you know. So something that I kind of thought was interesting is, like, this has come up a lot with these sort of pandering ones that we've been doing, of, like, these bands that feel like they're huge, but, like, we don't, you know, obviously, like, I feel like every time something MCR happens, like, on, you know, fucking Twitter, I realize that, like, I follow a million people who, like, love MCR that I didn't necessarily realize. But in general, like, this feels like a band that, like, was so big, but, like, not, like, I didn't know... It didn't feel like really immediate to me. And so this record did chart, like, it went to like number two on the Canadian album charts, but as a single, so this is what I think is really interesting, is in the States, this was like a top 10 Billboard Hot 100 single. I think it peaked at like number 9. And like, this was a number 1 single in the UK, tons of other places. This is like a top 10 single, but in Canada, so the album charts really well. The album does really well. But the single obviously just didn't get much in the way of radio play because it capped out at 32 in the Canadian singles charts. So like this was not, so for like Americans listening to this, like this was a song that you presumably were hearing on the radio and on MTV all the time, but it just did not register in the same way for Canadians, which I think explains a little bit of the distance that you and I at least have to the song and this band.
That's weird.
But I was really curious then. I was like, okay, so September 2006 is when the song comes out. What were the more popular songs in Canada than Welcome to the Black Parade at that time? What was getting more airplay? What are the things that you and I are more likely to have an intimate relationship with in this? And
I hope Sean found Desmond the week. I found the chart. Here.
Oh. Broke my fucking... Scroll down. So 32, Welcome to the Black Parade peaks, makes its debut in the week of September 30th, 2006.
Oh my God.
Welcome to the Black Parade. At number 31, also debuting the same fucking week, and similarly, I believe, peaking, is Josiah, would you like to read the song?
Only why you calling me so late.
That's right. It's Lips of an Angel by the pod's very own Hinder. So Hinder was more popular in Canada than My Chemical Romance, which doesn't explain why I never heard the song.
Well, maybe it does, because I feel like you've even said you don't have that deep relationship with this song as much.
I don't, so but it was like...
You seem to be like, you're only hanging out, when you're paying attention to the charts, you're only hanging out in like the top 20, I think.
Exactly. I'm a classics guy, but it is, so I did like one, I was like, so what else was more popular? But there's like songs that I legitimately have never heard. The David Usher song, The Music, you know, Not Ready to Make Nice, Dixie Chicks, that's a big tune. Smack That, Akon featuring Eminem. John Mayer, Sexy Back. There's some big tunes here, but there's also like Fallen Leaves by Billy Talent, Gym Class Heroes featuring Patrick Stump. But we also in the top 20 have two Avril Lavigne songs. So the number one song when My Chemical Romance were denied a spot even in the top 10 was Girlfriend by Avril Lavigne.
Incredible. Perfect song.
Which I feel.
I was hoping since it was Canadian that we'd get to see Sean Desmond. I really miss thinking about that handsome dancer. Sean
I mean,
Desmond.
We could think about him as much as you want, I guess.
I love him. I love because Sean Desmond. If you want to think about Sean Desmond, if you're listening to this, I love you. I'm sorry about...
So,
I'm sorry they switched you out with Shawn Mendes. So weird.
It's a disappointment to all of us. Now, despite the fact that this song wasn't super popular in Canada, obviously this song is like part of the lingua franca of the internet. Like the opening piano notes that when I was young, like those lyrics, right? Yeah. Those are like you see people posting them all the time. And so, you know, unfortunately there is not a dedicated, and there should be, Know Your Meme page for Black Parade memes. So I've taken fit to create a section that I like to call the Meme Zone, because Josiah, I know you love memes, and so wait,
before this is a new segment that we're doing?
It's a new segment called the Meme Zone.
I think it needs a better name, but okay, we'll keep it that.
Okay, what do you want to call it? We could call it the Share Zone.
Oh my God.
So let's. You and I are going to look at, I don't know, like a dozen, like two dozen, three dozen Black Parade memes, and you're going to rank them on a scale of your choosing. So this first one. It's from Reddit. When I was a young boy, my father took me to the city to see, and then there's a photo of the funeral dancers with the faces of My Chemical Romance pasted onto them. God. How do you feel about that meme?
Do I have to rank it by?
Well, or like a meme critique. Like, what do you think of this?
I think it sucks. Meme? I think it's terrible, and it's only from 2 years ago. They should have known better. Go fuck yourself. Okay. You should be banned from My Chemical Romance Reddit for that garbage.
Here's a verified meme from IGN, and it is the lyrics. So when I was a young boy, my father took me into the city as a marching band. He said, son, when you grow up, will you be the savior of the broken, the beaten, and the damned? And then there's just a photo of Robert Pattinson as Batman. What do you think about that meme,
terrible.
Josiah?
Fucking awful. Okay. Zero.
I agree.
100.
Okay, well, here's another Batman. We're in the Batman zone here. This is a sort of classic upper text, lower text image macro meme. And it is Batman, I believe it looks like from, maybe this is a scene from The Dark Knight Rises, sort of that siege scene. But
great flick.
A microphone. A great flick about how cops rock. And it appears that a microphone has been photoshopped into Batman's hands. At the top it says, when I was a young boy, my father took me into the city. And then the lower text says, and was murdered. Josiah, what do you think about that meme?
I mean, my quick answer is 0 out of 100. Fuck you. But also, I do think that the text is kind of funny.
You know, it's like it has a nice little twist that is very true to Batman's experience. But then adding this microphone and all, I don't know. It's just, it sucks. It's terrible. I hate it.
You're not a fan. Well, maybe you'll be more of a fan of this. It comes from Wattpad and the Book of Band Memes by Emo Frick. And it's a twist on the classic confused Nick Young meme. But he's been photoshopped to have black eyeliner, black lipstick, and a swoopy haircut. And the text above his confused face reads, "When your father takes you into the city and you don't see a marching band." Hmm? What do you think about that?
I fucking hate it so much. I think it's awful.
I feel like you don't like any of these memes so far. Let's see how you feel about this meme. This is actually from knowyourmeme.com, but I believe it's... I think
are you
going to
share
like
all these in Discord when this comes out?
I'll put the meme zone or whatever. If we can come up with a better name. So on Discord, please come up with a better name for the meme zone and we'll share these. This is, I guess, a riff on a Ben Shapiro meme that
I'm
not familiar
with. What if we called it Epic
with?
Meme Time? Kind of like Epic Meme Time.
Yeah, okay. Epic Meme Time is good. This is a Ben Shapiro meme that I guess is, let's say hypothetically, is I guess the meme, and then it's something that Ben Shapiro has not said, because I guess that's sort of his version of what was the Travis Barker thing where he was like, my statement on this fact is,
I can't remember. Now I got a whitelist, my ad blocker for Know Your Meme. Okay, here we go.
Oh, you haven't whitelisted Know Your Meme before?
I'm sorry for stealing from you.
Well, look, I can just tell you, it's a photo of Ben Shapiro and a photo of Gerard Way, and it says, let's say hypothetically, and then it's just the lyrics to the song.
I don't think that's the same guy, maybe?
I don't really understand what the implication
Piece
of that
shit
meme is.
Terrible.
Okay, how about this? This comes from Image Flip, and it's a four-panel comic where Jason Voorhees is trying to find his latest victim. But the victim is like a swoop-haired kind of emo. He's kind of confused. He's got his knife. He's looking around. And then Jason says, when I was a young, so the lyrics are wrong here. When I was a young, my father took me into the city. And then the emo victim, unable to avoid singing along, says, to see a marching band, ah, crap, revealing their location to Jason Voorhees. Josiah, how do you feel about this meme?
Love the typo. Fucking hate the meme.
I think that's a good meme.
I like the idea that kind of thinking about how the emo was probably a victim long before Jason even showed up. If you think about that.
Interesting. That there's layers to that. That's really good. Here's one that I think you'll really like.
I can't resist, actually.
So this is, it's simply, again, it's sort of top text, bottom text. The top image is just literally the lyrics to the song and is still from the video. And then it is below that Ron Burgundy having a beer saying, well, that escalated quickly.
Okay. You've won me over. There we go.
Honestly, when I grabbed that one, I was like, Josiah is going to love this one for sure. Here's one from memegenerator.net, and it's
so
literally just the text of the song over a photo of a minion. Josiah, how do you feel about this?
These are getting a lot better. I like how it says the broken, the beaten, and the damed at the end. Also,
the damed. what do you think about that meme?
It rules.
Okay, so I think I just sent you another one, right? Did you just get the meme arsenal?
Meme arsenal,
link?
Yeah.
This is the classic Drake shunning, Drake loving meme. And in Drake shunning, he is shunning the lyrics to the song in English, and then he is pointing and smiling at the lyrics in what appears to be Russian, I think. A little bit of a topical meme. Josiah, how do you feel about that one?
You know, it's a little spicy, but I think sometimes these things need to be said. I like it. I really like
it. It's true. Here's one that is almost like a real meme, and this comes from ifunny.co, and it's that photo of like the kind of, you know, smiling looking kind of normal suburban dad giving presents to a sad-faced emo in a Lex on Fire shirt with his arms crossed, and the text says, when your father doesn't take you into the city to see the marching band. Josiah, what do you think about this meme?
I hate it so much. You know, I think if you're going to do this segment, I think you need to really get your chef hat on and start building, telling some kind of story, because you were in a real sweet spot and now you've just made me angry again with this one.
Okay, well, how about, maybe you'll like this one. This also comes from Know Your Meme, and it is a sort of combination photo of the video, and then it looks like someone from My Little Pony, Friendship is Magic, and they're saying, when I was a young colt, my father took me into the city to see a trotting band. Mm-hmm. Josiah, how do you feel about this?
I like it. I like it. I like
this,
that one.
You like that meme? Okay, well, here's another. This is a meme from Twitter, and hold on, I'm just opening this up myself. This meme comes from the user at Goth Spider Bitch. The text says, when I was a young boy, my father took me into the city to see a marching band. He said, son. And then there was a photo of Bernie Sanders in front of the Black Parade music video saying, I'm once again asking if you will be the savior of the broken, the beaten, and the damned. Josiah, how do you feel about this meme?
Just trying to see what the mutual situation is. Okay, yeah, I can go ahead and safely say, fuck this meme. Piece of shit. Garbage meme.
Okay, well, maybe you'll like this meme, because this one popped up a lot. Like, it looks like, and to be honest, I feel like we need to find out if this is a known quantity, because I saw this meme then utilized further. But there's it's sort of a social media profile photo of a user, and this comes from iFunny.co again, but the Brazilian iFunny.co. The text says, when I was a young boy, my father took me into the city, and then there's the user photo, and their name is Amar Shaban. Can you do me a quick favor, Josiah, and just Google Amar Shaban and see if, like, we should know who Amar Shaban is, or if that's simply a joke about someone with the name Amar Shaban?
I think, they just only pop up in that meme. But Michael Hudson used to do that meme a lot. One of the great
Oh, that's a classic meme. Twitter. Here we go. This is a Twitter meme.
I found
meme
his Facebook,
from,
actually. It's, and he has
Amar Shaban.
Yeah, he has that picture.
Good for Amar Shaban. This is another Twitter meme from FanFastMantises user, and it has the text, but when the father takes you to the marching band, he said, and it's the meme of the father walking in on the son, and he is saying, son, are you winning? Josiah, how do you feel about this
I feel
meme?
Really bad about it. I feel horrible.
Okay, well, how do you feel about this image flip meme? And perhaps you can tell me this makes sense. It's like the sort of full-color baby classic
to
meme.
Kill but, me?
But
trying to kill me?
Yeah, how does it fucking feel, man? This is a photo of... this is a Big Bird in front of the sort of color meme, and it says, when I was a young boy, my father took me into the city to see a Martian band. I don't know that that makes any sense to me. Does
There's
that make
some
any
kind
sense
of, like, PA or something with him. No, yeah, I don't get it. I like that one, because I don't understand it.
Well, here you go. This you might understand. It comes from Reddit. This comes from user Zedbucks. And it's the classic kind of Winnie the Pooh getting progressively fancier. And so it's the initial lyrics as Pooh is looking kind of normal and slovenly. And then as he gets a little fancier, as an adolescent, my paternal progenitor and I went to the Metropolis to spectate a Philharmonic. Thank you. Wow. Look at I've been reading a lot of words here. And then the final frame, Winnie the Pooh has transformed into the full outfit from the Black Parade. And the image is, the text is such that you can sort of hear the sound of Gerard singing it, emphasized in certain ways. Josiah, how do you feel about this meme?
Sucks.
Okay. Maybe you'll like this one. This is a Facebook meme.
It's like a game show.
This comes from the Facebook page Sad and Bougie, and it's Grogu has been photoshopped into what appears to be a scene from Empire or Jedi with Yoda, and the text says, me as a young boy with my father who took me into the city to see a marching band.
Awful. Absolutely
I thought
awful.
You might like that one because it's so bad. Here's one from friend of the pod Mabson on Twitter. It's the text about going into the city to see a marching band, but then one of the classic image macros, and it just is the Hobbit, the Desolation of Smog, with the photos of the band.
Who's those other guys? I don't know.
I don't know who those.
Mabson is a pimp. Like, this is the kind of shit that I like to see. It's so good.
Well, here's one that I liked. Let's see how you feel about this, because this is a meme that didn't get its fair due. It was over too soon. This comes from the user Trash, because why not? And the text says, when my father took me into the city to see this, and it is the Here Come Dad Boy meme, but in black and white, wearing the Black Parade
so
text,
depressing.
And it says, when I was a young boy, spelled in the style
it's
of...
so depressingly awful, and it has one
no,
like.
No, you can't possibly feel that way. I think that one's great. In fact, I'd retweet that, but I feel like I'd be spoiling...
Yeah, you gotta leave it in place.
Well, look, in the grand tradition of Kardashians, you know, in the spirit of punk news, wait, did I send that one to you? Yeah, I did. This comes from punky.com, Australia, actually. You know, of course, the meme where Kim Kardashian is saying, I like dropping hints that I'm, what, I actually can't even remember
what I have no clue what this is. I don't know.
So, you know, the thing where Kim Kardashian is like, I'm dropping hints that I'm whatever, and then she's just saying exactly that. So, in this version, this twist on the classic meme format, Kim Kardashian is saying, I like dropping hints that I'm still emo, and then underneath it, she is, reciting the lyrics to the Black Parade. Josiah, how do you rank this meme?
I mean, I hate them all, but I feel, I don't know, neutral on this one, I guess.
Well, I've got great news for you. This is the last meme, and look, I'm not chefing it up. This is just the order in which I found Black Parade memes. This comes from the website memedroid.com, and I know you love a clever brand account as much as anyone.
How many, like, malware meme websites are there now? Like,
I Bored Panda
probably owns an island somewhere where they, like...
Yeah, exactly. I'm doing my part to keep the digital media landscape alive and kicking. This is, you know, of course, again, Josiah, you're a huge fan of clever brand accounts, I know.
Oh, yeah.
So it's goated. User Cammy Bloodmoon has added Wendy's, and this is from 2017, with the lyrics, when I was a young boy, my father took me into the city to eat at a Wendy's. And Wendy's has responded. He said, son, when you grow up, will you eat a Baconator triple, some nuggets, and some fries?
It's just fucking awful. It's so bad. How?
And with that, we are exiting the epic meme time.
And the bulk of the episode. We're just going to talk about... that's kind of all we have to say about the song Welcome to the Black Parade by MCR. So let's listen to some covers, why don't we? Welcome, Black Parade.
Oh, that was good.
That doesn't really make sense because there's no break in the episode. I mean, we just peed.
Oh, you are welcoming me, Black, from like our tea and coffee break. What a dainty couple of boys we are. Just a little tea and coffee break.
Just have a nice little get some refreshments. It's like we're at church. Yeah, that's it. We are at church. We're taking him to church to worship like a dog. That's true.
Moses is here.
I'm just vamping because I have so many tabs open with fucking My Chemical Romance memes. I can't even find the watch together. Here we go. All right, let's get started with some parodies before we do the covs. So here's...
Oh, we're in the parody zone.
Yeah. Oh, do we need a name for that? You just want to call everything... You just want to rip on Da Share Zone.
That's it. Have you guys seen this user is funny stuff. It's real twisted. I hope nothing untoward is going on behind the scenes. I hope no one's fucking anyone's wife or whatever happened there.
Yeah, I don't really know. But Cammy Ang Black Allegedly. Parade. This is, I think, from the Philippines I read. I don't really get what the parody is because it's not in English. But I think they do say the word eyeliner in English. So we can at least know that there's something about eyeliner in the... Cammy Ang Black Parade. Welcome to the Black Parade parody.
This guy's like blinking a lot, sort of like they've just stepped into the sun, maybe. And now it's a totally new guy.
Singing.
A lot of fresh guys. There's like been four different guys. So,
yeah. Oh, emo. I see the word emo.
Picture.
Black. Eyeliner.
Okay, yeah.
Yo, bangs.
What is Naka bang? But it's a
t-shirt. T-shirt. Fitted.
T-shirt I fitted.
Sneakers. See, I think YouTube emo parodies are a universal language.
It's true.
We're not so different after all. Feeling.
This person is selling it.
Was there a filter? Or like a... Or did
there's something going on there.
That's... like, what? Does that have to look crazy?
Yeah.
So anyways, sick. I think it's a parody about... Maybe that seems to be almost the same as the normal song about, like, going into joining a black parade. I guess in this black parade, they become emo.
As opposed to dead, yeah.
Actually, I keep changing my mind on what to play next. I'm going to stick with this nut one next. But this one is kind of like, it's definitely sucks a lot. So, you know, it's not up to the standard of what we usually play on here. But this is also from Mad TV. So that's
kind of... Oh, what?
Yeah.
Mad TV.
The classics. You are watching Crazy.
Mad. It's called The Black Tirade. I can't figure out who this singer is. Guy named
Kramer. I mean, it looks like the patient is being played by, what's his name? Michael.
The Kramer is that guy, Michael whatever, McDonald or something.
Yeah.
But the singer I don't recognize. I think Keegan Key is in this at one point.
You know, really a lot of success stories out of Mad TV.
I know, despite the fact that, like, as someone who loves Mad Magazine so much, terrible show, absolutely awful.
There was definitely a point when I was a kid where I preferred Mad TV to SNL.
Well, the main thing I loved was the Rudolph parody that was like the Mafia.
Oh, yeah. Was, so.
This sketch also seems weirdly high budget.
This is just really detailing this classic cultural memory we all have.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. Is it Eugene Merman? Was he on Mad TV?
I don't know. What.
Also, they're parodying the song. They could just play the actual song. They don't need to change it. So, basically, it's a parody of the Black Parade video. And I love that it's only going through one channel, also. It really helps.
Director Spike Lee, a little classic,
Racial humor from Mad.
So. You know what? If there's one thing that this podcast is also known for is our classic racial humor. So I'm glad we found a way to incorporate that.
I feel like just the thing about Mad TV and actually SNL though too is like it's just like it's just combining two things for and doing nothing with it. Just like two things happen at the same time. It's like Mad Libs, like My Chemical Romance and Michael Richards. Let's just combine them for together. No reason.
And you know what? I enjoyed it. So thank you, Mad TV. You know, once again, better than SNL. For
this
sure.
one is confirmed. Sort of. So this final parody, I don't know who the user is, but this one is really, I think, important. This is a parody called May I Take Your Order? I think it's kind of a parody of, like, you know, nasty, dumb fast food workers. This is JJ and Sky Fishow. Fishow, probably. That's. The comments are turned off on this.
Oh, this is from 2016. Interesting.
It's really good, though. There's so many dips and
they're
nuggies.
Sort of playing the piano with the different dips. This is good.
The Fierce Four. Interesting.
When I was a young boy,
oh, yes.
My father took me to Burger
So there's like three kids kind of sitting on a... on a
he said,
this is hard to describe.
It's really hard to describe.
I think kids can have some fries with them.
It's like,
don't forget your coat.
There's four kids that were like sitting around at a bus stop, and then now it's cut to them in the play place.
How good that they are.
And like, none of these, like, this is, I will just say this, it's incredible that there's four kids here, and like, none of them are able to sing. Like, it's just
Hannah.
This is a savage parody.
We joined the Black Parade.
Okay, yeah, they're dabbing. They're dabbing on the beat.
So wait, this from 2016? Is that dab era?
That even seems late for a dab.
When I was a young
boy, kind of whisper
right up the octave.
Took me to. Why is
it?
He said,
"Sign your." Yes, kid just went down the slide and dabbed.
Did Burger King pay for this?
This is definitely SpawnCon. This is like part of that era of like Cock Rock and the Subservient Chicken and all the kind of sick viral Burger King advertising.
Oh my god, we're not even halfway done. They're just eating the birds. I know. You know, I think we're going to skip a lot of things, but I really do want to see where this one goes.
Yeah, this one is worth seeing through.
He's watching over me. And other times I think it's diabetes.
Whoa.
Also, I feel like the age range between these kids is, like, kind of substantial.
There's, like, a tiny little boy pushing them around the merry-go-round.
My favorite thing is watching kids do half-hearted dabs. Like, the kid just did the most. Like, he kind of just, like, dabbed into his, like, wrist.
What I never understand is when you make lyrics that are, like, sound like they're being made up as they go, How do you write lyrics that sound so bad? They have such few sensical turns of phrase and no rhyme scheme at all. Like, how do you then get someone else to memorize that? Is guess what I'm trying to say? It's like, it feels so unwritten, but it clearly is. It's like uncanny.
Well, we're talking over it. I think it's actually pretty good. I don't know. I don't know why you're dissing these fun kids. Oh, they're doing a fun dance.
I'm saying that they're kind of like true artists,
right? How did they even accomplish this?
Yeah, they've achieved this, like,
your feeble realm of understanding.
Yeah.
Okay, that's fine.
They've tapped into like something sublime.
Damn! Imagine if they also did a Sublime parody.
This is so insane. This is so good.
This is like incredible. As far as I'm concerned, this is like, once again, this is canon. This is the song now.
That's the new Sam Sam phrase.
Yeah, I know, right?
I also am curious how they recorded this.
Yeah.
They record it all around a phone and then they lip synced after? Or is one of these the live take?
Oh, yeah, interesting, yeah.
I know you probably don't believe me, but you're the reason we'll eat some more.
The younger kid is, like, kind of getting tired of it. One of them just kind of had to poke him to, like, kind of keep going.
Eat some fries and eat some ketchup, honey mustard, eat some barbecue, sweet and sour, ranch and sesame, eat one and all.
Eat some more.
I want to know who filmed this. Like, was this filmed by a parent, or like, is there another sibling?
Yes. Oh my god, that was incredible.
Is there anything, like, what else is on that YouTube page?
Yeah, it's mostly just like a vlog channel now. JJ and Sky Fischow. Seems to be having some roller skating progress, cozy fall movie night, you know, just popping. I mean, just when you put out that kind of joy into your Burger King themed My Chemical Romance cover, obviously that's a sign of a larger, richer life being lived, and it's all happening on that YouTube channel. So God bless
that's
those kids.
Absolutely true. Absolutely true.
Now we're moving into the TV zone. I think we should start probably actually with Kelly Oki. This is, of course, Kelly Clarkson doing a rendition of the tune on her TV show.
Oh, yeah, because we were at some point going to, like, see if we could get Kelly Clarkson, right?
Yeah.
We did get, I think we can say, we did get officially turned down by Kevin Smith.
When celebs turn down the show, no matter how big they are, I will never forgive them.
Oh, yeah, no, it's like Kevin Smith is on my shit list. Now, I've supported that man. I went to the movies pop-up.
Yeah, fuck that guy.
Fuck him.
I don't know, like, this seems really weird. I know that Kelly Clarkson is, like, obviously punk as fuck.
Yeah, confirmed.
But if you had your own, like, daytime talk show, would you just do, like, show and tell and, like, be like, check out this song that I want to do?
I mean,
for no reason.
I feel like based on the name of the segment, this is probably part of why people tune into the Kelly Clarkson show is for Kelly Oki. Maybe I'm wrong, but that's my impression. Oh, this is great. This is not as good as those kids, though, man.
The guitar tone is so gross. All right, shout out Kelly. I mean, Kelly Clarkson rocks. This is from
Kelly Clarkson. Come on the pod, though.
The Voice Indonesia. We didn't try Kelly Clarkson officially.
Was Nate Rufus on The Voice Indonesia, or was he only on the feeble American version?
Yeah, I don't think he's ever made it.
When I was a younger, my father.
Which is kind of her outfit appears sort of like Black Parade inspired,
bit of a reference, yeah.
Clever, I see it.
I see what you've done there.
I recognize it from those memes. You grow up.
Okay, if you like this, turn your chair around. No, don't. Everything's gonna get fucked up. If I turn my chair, everything's gonna fall apart.
Yeah, like I could. Yeah. We already lost the connection. Defeat them.
Your demons.
This full ass marching band that is absolutely not playing.
Yeah, I don't think you should. Because one day, when you have all these quite literal bells and whistles, or I guess just drums. That's kind of cheating. It's called The Voice, not the band.
Damn. Oh, yeah, rock it.
We're only going to give you a second to rock.
Oh. Look at Kyle, what are you doing there?
Whoa, look at this cool person at the bottom.
The host, yeah.
Sometimes I got the feeling she's watching over me.
Oh, there's some cool strings.
All right. I would be like one of the dancers totally fucked that up. Just that was pretty funny.
One of the dancers what?
Fucked it up, like sort of.
Oh, hell yeah.
Oh, this looks good. What is this?
This is a compilation of awesome rock auditions worldwide. Number 21 okay, cool. Or 25 in the series. And this is actually a bonus video in the compilation. Thanks for asking. This is a bonus because it's, I don't know why. This is, I don't, we'll see. Bonus video. Here we go. Bonus video. Norway contestants finale. So I guess this is Norway.
I think it's a bonus video.
The Voice, or I don't know. It's some kind of TV show.
It's Eurovision.
But do they do covers on there?
They should.
This guy looks so much like, Akiva.
He does, yeah. Like, 100%. He specifically looks like Akiva in the These Are the Things in My Jeep video.
Yeah.
I didn't relate to that because I had different things in my teeth. Will you be the savior? Sorry, the great thing about that was like it opened up with him playing the opening up with piano, and as soon as he started singing, he stopped playing piano, which is just like a very funny bit of like breaking kayfabe.
Yeah. People love to have like fucking marching skeleton guys.
Yeah, like that is like a necessary part of covering this song, eh? Yeah. I can't believe how much he looks like.
It's crazy.
and like literally, it's that outfit. Like.
So yeah, this looks like it's from some kind of. I can't even make out what the watermark is. ARK? This is called ARK?
Oh, I read that as NRK.
You turned colorful. The set is giving me some kind of Got Talent vibes. Rather than the spinning chair.
Yeah, it feels like these people have talent. It's a good song.
It's so good. I should have listened to it.
A great bonus video. Yeah, you should check it out sometime. You've seen the memes. You kind of got it all already.
Well, this one I think we're not going to watch much of, but it's some sort of YouTuber content where they do the song in 22 different styles.
Oh, yes.
And I don't want to watch much of it.
I don't think I like 22 different styles of music.
Anthony
you?
Vincent is when the music. Is in the style of My Chemical Romance, apparently. 22 styles, yeah, I don't know. Rock, hard rock, classic rock.
Yeah, those are all good.
That's it. Elvis.
I've seen a few of these guys' videos and, like, looking against my better. He's in some funny videos.
Yeah, he seems pretty talented.
Like, if you were, you know.
It's true. It's, like, undeniably good.
It feels like it's for like a different. Imagine you smoked weed, you know?
And yeah.
You might find yourself watching this from time to time.
If I smoked weed, I wouldn't have gotten COVID.
That's, yeah.
He turned this Queen one into like a whole video.
Like, that's a good Queen. Like, this is as these YouTubers go, you know?
It's true.
There is a video of them performing this with Brian May, because it is obviously over the top. Like Queen pop punk. It's pretty sick, but it didn't seem very sharp.
Okay, we're going to stop at Ale Storm.
Yeah, we flew too close to the sun. Yeah,
it's quite enough of that.
All the classic genres, David Bowie, Queen, and Ale Storm.
You know, I was just thinking about how, like, being really good at impressions is kind of a, must be a real, I can't think of the turn of phrase, but it must be a blessing and a curse. And then it got me thinking, no one ever really requested us to do it. We were going to do an impressions, Lucy, and no one ever talked to us about it. And now we never will.
No one is ever like, where's the, I just had to, like, I'm working on something where I just needed to, like, fake some voiceover real quick for a sizzle reel. And I realized that, like, contextually, the voice had to be Australian.
Oh,
like,
my God. On, really?
And so it was just, like, me in here being like, hey, can you do me? Like, real, like, border. Like, I felt racist about it.
Oh, my
like,
God.
I'll share it with you when it's done.
Is it publicly? Can you share
no,
it with
No, this
pod?
Is not going to be a public. This will never be a publicly available. But I am going to try to get money from other people for my Australian accent.
I can't, like, drop your Australian accent in the pod as a nugget.
I'll send you the just like raw file of me saying this. Can you say better line, miss? Can you say better line?
This is called Half Lives. Is the name of this one. I skipped some of the other people we've played a whole bunch this month, like Halloween. I wanted to find some other, like, Brooding Mamas on YouTube.
Yeah, Brooding Mamas. That's my favorite genre.
Yeah,
when
me too.
I was a young girl, my father
oh, gender swap.
Into the city to see a marching band.
She kind of has like a Irish voice.
You grow up, would you
I guess that would be called an
be
accent.
Like, I would hate to say, but yeah, what is
the broken, the beaten, and the damned? He said, will you defeat them?
I don't think that's Irish.
Your demons.
It's just like an affectation.
Italy. What you're hearing is infected Italian.
Oh, wow. She's kind of, honestly, I was going to say she's kind of dressed like a rocker from the Degrassi The Next Generation, but she's quite literally just dressed exactly like Boy George.
Yeah.
But like with a cover like this, you think it's going to come in all rocking and then it just stays like,
Sometimes I get the feeling she's watching over me.
Rude.
Times I feel like I should go.
Everyone is looking so
and
focused.
Through it all, the rise and fall, bodies in the streets. And when you're gone, we want you all to know.
All right, let's keep him going. Some kind of spooky thing, I think. The Last Sleepless City. Oh, that is actually really scary for some reason.
Oh, we got the red tie. Red tie is on.
Oh, yeah, this guy is like very.
When I was a young
Ooh,
boy,
that's a voice.
My father.
He's wearing like
took me
black and white movie
to
face
see
paint. Like,
yeah.
Do you see that? He's made up his. Like, just turn down
he
the grayscale, bro. You don't need to do all that shit.
Would you be?
Drummer has famous stars and straps. Tank. Something about how this is shot is very unnerving.
Well, only the singer has, like, makeup on it. It's fucking scary. And then, the drummer and the guitar player are like then almost like the colors are too bright, like all the redness in their face is like really distracting.
And then like the weird like lens flares I think are so fake.
Yeah.
That it just it looks like kind of CGI and evil.
Yeah, this is spooky. Oh, now he's got a wait, now he's in color.
Maybe because he's about to start rocking.
So you can see that hair.
Oh, this part is so good.
This is great because they're like cutting between them and they just showed the singer adjusting his glasses.
All right, we don't have time
for
this
rocking. That's a more serious register.
Here's an acoustic cover. Oh, wait. Okay, this one's really important, actually. This is not just an acoustic cover.
This is actually an acoustic cover from Cedar Creek Church in Northwestern Ohio. So this is part of their student ministry. So they're just like trying to be down with the kids.
Okay, cool.
In 2012.
So once again, like perhaps some Christian energy here.
Oh yeah.
When I was a young boy.
Oh, what the fuck? Why is it lit like that? Like, it's lit like a, like, he looks like fucking Boris Karloff. In the, it
looks like a dramatic recreation of a mugging.
It looks like the poster art for, like, Frankenstein. It's so weird. The savior of the broken. Why? This is, I would go to church to avoid having to go to hell with this man. Your demons
and all the yeah, it's like the lighting and the smoke machines are not helping. And the guitarist faux hawk is incredible.
Yeah. A phantom to lead you in
the summer to join the black. They're all kind of dressed like different TV movie versions of hackers.
Oh yeah. That's Crash and that's Burn. Oh yeah, that Chris Carrabba.
Yes, bro. Fuck yes.
Oh yeah.
Gallery. So kind of keeping it in the same sort of acoustic energy.
Wow.
This guy is kind of the opposite of a youth pastor, I think.
He's an old Satanist.
Could be. This is Danny Michaud, and he says, been ripping up this song on my boat for a few days, so I decided to share it with you. Cheers, everybody. Hashtag acoustic, hashtag cover, hashtag boat life.
Yeah.
So this is just Danny on his boat. He's got a flaming music note tattooed on his chest, and he's just fucking raring. He's got a killer tan, and he's just raring to go.
I'd like to welcome you all to the Black Parade. Because when I was a young boy,
what is his? He's got a tattoo, like kind of over his chest, that's just like a flaming, like black and white, like a flaming treble clef.
Yeah.
He said, "Son,
so good.
You grow up, you be the savior of the broken."
I mean, he's just like
the beaten and the damned. He said, "Will you defeat them?"
There's something about this vocal delivery where you're just like, your head is just like bobbling every which way while you're singing.
Yeah, he's really like swinging it around.
Because one day I leave you a phantom to lead you in the
sick as hell
to join the black parade.
Oh, I'd love to go on that guy's boat with
him. Boat life seems awesome.
So this one I just thought was like the first bit was really weird. This like angle of her pressing record and then sitting, just edit that out maybe. It's very strange.
I know, it's just raw. I want to make it like feel real, you know?
This one's actually really good though. This is Nana Faulkner with a piano cover.
When I was a young girl,
There's a ukulele though sitting in the background that's very threatening to me.
Oh, we're going to have some uke time.
I know we're going to have some uke times.
He said, girl, when you grow up, would you be?
See, she's doing some affectations, but she doesn't sound Irish. Well, maybe it's because she's not Italian.
Yeah.
Maybe when Italian sings in cursive, they sound Irish.
I think that's it. This is nice. Not a fault. Great name, too.
I mean, the song is just Pachelbel's Canon, so.
The classic.
So, okay, this next one, I love this one because it has a great... Oh, maybe he explains at the start, but just in case he doesn't, I want to read you the description of the video real quick. Aaron H. Music says, a cover of My Chemical Romance's Welcome to the Black Parade, recorded the vocals in one take and forgot the auto-tune was on. And did this because I wanted to record the guitar for some time now. So he wanted to play the guitar, but then he just kind of...
Hey guys, it's Aaron again. Just moved into the new place, so I finally have time to record and upload a new video. This is a Welcome to the Black Parade by My Chemical Romance cover. I did use autotune again. I cannot sing nearly as high as Gerard Way could. But I enjoyed it. I thought it was pretty fun to do. And I hope you guys enjoy it too. Thanks.
Wait. Thanks, in the description, he says he forgot the autotune was on. And then in the video, he admits that it was on. What's that? What's the deal with that, Aaron?
Oh,
which is it?
Deceptive Aaron here.
Maybe he doesn't even know what he...
Oh, this is great. This kind of sounds like this band 100 Gex that I'm really into, because I'm like...
It really actually does sound insanely cool. I don't think he realizes.
Yeah, this is fucking awesome.
When he uploaded this 11 years ago, I don't think he realized.
Like that he, this is basically like, he's setting this the standard for contemporary music. Wow.
It's so cool.
Wow.
It sounds so hip.
It's so contemporary.
And also the guitarist, you nailed it. You killed it, Aaron, all around. Good job. Great job, buddy. Okay, no, we're not ready for this one yet. That's the wrong order. This one was uploaded in an hour loop, so I thought it must be worth... Unless it's just a self-promotional tool to upload your own thing in an hour loop.
This video is not moving for you, right?
No, it's... No, but can you hear it?
Yeah.
Sophia Carlberg's Welcome to the Black Parade cover, 1 hour loop. You think that someone made a 1 hour loop of their own thing to get... No, this is uploaded like by Music Loop 1 hour. Like, it's like a... This is like a generator did this.
Again, I think we've determined that there are definitely some like spooky computer to real life vibes happening here.
Oh, this person singing is like a huge influencer or singer or something. Sophia Carlberg, Swedish singer songwriter. Because one day, yeah, so that's why I guess they looped it. Sounds good.
Yeah, this is. I would listen to this for an hour.
Well, we could.
Let's just sit here and kind of just let it run.
Okay, let's check out this instead. This little Austin Townsend, the classic blue YouTube upload. And it's also a .wmv file.
Hi, I'm Austin Townsend.
What generates that blue thing? Is that like, was that like Microsoft Movie Maker or something?
It must have been. He's got a crooked Ohio State flag on his... Wait, that church was from Ohio as well.
Big Ohio energy this week.
Maybe he...
Our guest is from Ohio. Or really? Like lives in Ohio.
Really?
Yeah. It's all happening in Ohio. There's been a lot of Ohio. Like, February, we had big Ohio energy, too. I think half the guests were from Ohio.
Damn. What does that say about us? I'm afraid to pontificate.
Yes.
This kid rules, Austin. Okay, do you want to, like, be bummed out and then delighted, or delighted and then bummed out?
Bummed out, then delighted. It's like bad news first.
Okay. Well, then we're going to listen to this. This is, like, the most uke energy.
Uke with a capo? Like, yeah. The uke wasn't high and twee enough to start.
This guy has, like, crazy anime hair. Cameron Sanderson.
Oh no.
He's singing like Beirut.
Yeah, it gave me a fucking shiver. To see
you marching by. Bond.
He said, son, when.
He says, share with MCR, please. PLEZ. This is my rendition of the amazingly fabulous song The Black Parade by the one and only MCR on ukulele and vocals.
He said, will you defeat them, you demons?
This is so fucked up.
The plaza they
I don't
made.
Like this.
Because one day I'll leave you. It's I'm like I kind of want to click away because I don't like him looking at me.
I know. Especially when he like looks away to think and then looks back.
And looks back like he's thought of it.
That little emote cam was so good. And this part.
Oh, I literally have goosebumps. Like I'm fucking. He's like pointing at his chest right now. Me, my father. Da 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 da.
He said, "Son, when da, 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 da." So I wanted to show you that the uke can be uked for evil,
but it can also really. Thank you.
But it can also be uked for good, and that's because there's this unbelievably charming one by these kids, Koi and Moi. I mean, before we even look at this scene, look at this beautiful scene.
Okay.
They're sitting on this like cool, ornate kind of wooden bench that has this beautiful carpentry on it. And then there's Christmas Santa Claus pillows. They're sitting behind a nativity set. This is from
this is cute.
2019. I mean, already looking at it, you're like, this is fucking adorable. Now listen.
Yeah,
listen,
I love them. They are my friends.
Listen to Koi and Moi.
When I was a young boy, my father took me into the city.
The other kids just smiling warmly. Yeah, these kids are like, how old are they? Like, what are they, six? When you
grow up, I mean, I don't know how to like look at a kid and age them. I feel like that's not a good skill that you should have.
He said, "Will you defeat?" I hope the other kid never sings.
That's what I was thinking too, but I previewed it earlier.
Okay. This is so enchanting. Like, this is just like a blessed image.
It is.
I didn't know I needed this.
I think the other kid is kind of like very, very slightly.
Whoa, he's kind of having some fun.
He's like strumming with such confidence. It's crazy.
I can't strum this confidently. This is honestly, but also. Oh. This is, wait, does this have a million views?
It has 4,000 views.
That's not enough.
I know. They're so good. They're so unbelievably good. It's hard to turn them off. I love those kids.
I know. Oh, my God. Well, we did watch the entirety of the Burger King parody videos. That didn't eat up a lot of time. Oh, a School of Rock in the woods.
Yeah, this is a School of Rock Columbia, the house band. I just thought this was a nice scene, kind of like
on that's the thing. There's like some hay bales. Watching on some hay bales. There's a fire in the foreground. Wait, did you say this is Columbia?
I don't know if it means like it says School
Columbia,
of
Ohio.
Oh my, isn't that Columbus?
Yeah, that's true. my lack of Ohio knowledge.
I like that we just know less and less every week somehow. I can't figure out where this is.
Well, it's at Falcon's Fest.
It really does look like it says Falcon's Fest. These like School of Rock bands always have like 100 kids.
I'm trying to figure out where Falcon's Fest is, though.
I know we're in a bit of a time crunch, so I'm trying to be strategic to make sure we play the best ones.
Calling it a time crunch, we had 2 hours. We had 2 full hours.
I know. I got to play the
I
best one.
I recently did a podcast with some friends of the pod, some folks in the nation. They'll be coming out soon. And because I had a meeting in the morning, I needed to stop by like 11:30 at night and was accused of being in a time crunch.
Yeah.
It's not right. People are overusing this term.
This is an 8-minute video.
The second half of the annual Pompa Rock High School Talent Show.
There's so many high school talent shows.
Is this a
teacher
or is this a student pretending to be a teacher?
Me, a Steven DeWild. You know, our next act
features a man.
Like, I truly can't tell if it's a young teacher or a student in a suit, like, pretending to be
Matthew Kelly.
I wonder if we need to do a talent a talent show, Scoosie.
I think we do. I think we do.
Matt Kelly goes to me and goes, "Hey, Steve, how many music directors does it take to change a light bulb?" I go, "Matt, one, Matt?" He goes, "Who knows? No one's paying attention anyway."
Oh, do you think this guy is the music director? Is that the joke?
Okay, here we go. It takes like so long to set up. These kids are so cool.
This is all real time, eh?
Yeah, just like, why did they open the curtain and then have them set up? There was a huge red curtain in front of these kids.
This is like a real, like, you had all summer kind of. Yeah, like they're doing their sound check here. These kids are also very formally dressed. We've got the piano player. He's got his shirt tucked in. Nice button up, and the guitar player has his shirt tucked in, but to jeans, a little open at the top, a little over the skate, and then a leather vest.
When I was a young boy, my father took me into the city.
This is definitely the best of the talent shows, I found. So.
Yeah. It's kind of too good.
We'll save the others for talent show exclusive.
Talent show exclusive would be great. They gotta turn up that guitar. This kid was shredding and I can't hear it.
The marching drums are so funny to me for some reason.
Like, just when it's not, like, sort of fully, like, produced, you know?
Yeah.
It's just like when you're just raw marching. Oh, yeah, let's see. Okay, here we go. Big shredding. Oh, surprise.
Oh, there's another kid wearing a vest.
Is this like the school uniform? Oh, yeah. The guitar player just put one foot up on the kick drum to shred.
So good. All right, we gotta keep it moving.
Talent show's rocking.
Better keep it moving since Sam doesn't have any fucking time on Earth for us anymore. He doesn't give a shit. He'd prefer if we just didn't even do the show anymore.
Yeah, that is what I'm getting at.
Okay, no, I think there's one that's like really important, but I don't want to just give it away. I want to push it right to the edge here. So let's check out. Let me see here. Well, let's real quick just give, because I'm so thankful that they exist. Let's just give Postmodern Jukebox a second.
With oh, fucking Christ. I thought maybe you're going to get to it, but I did see, and I realized, like, we don't see enough of videos that are like the fake music videos from amusement parks. And I'm hoping that that's what I was looking at there for a second.
Oh, it's not actually.
Okay, because like, did you like at Canvas Wonderland? They always had like the thing where you'd go and you just like lip sync in front of a green screen to.
Oh yeah, I forgot about that.
And you could like stand. I never did it, but you just stand around outside and like look at the videos. And even at that time, I was like, "This is fucking insane." And I bet now they look like transcendent.
I wonder if they even exist anymore. Yeah,
someone must have.
That's it. That would be a sick find. So yeah. This is Postmodern Jukebox New Orleans marching band cover featuring Joey Cook. I'm sure they start cooking. And,
oh yeah, they're going.
She does a lot of things, and there's also a live video of her performing it. Joey Cook. Well, carry on. She's kind of dressed like a Nutcracker or a MCR type of person. She's doing all kinds of little
MCR type of person. Really sounds like you're trying super hard to not say a slur. Like it's a an MCR type of person.
Well, what do you call all this marching band shit? I don't know.
MCR type people.
Okay, are you ready for like the greatest find on Earth?
Yeah, I am.
This lady is named Anna Rammel. She has a cover channel that I'm surprised isn't super viral. I mean, some people follow it, but not nearly enough. This is Anna Rammel. So showing an actual marching band, and here we go.
When I was
a young girl,
my father took
took me. So she's it like obligatory that you have to swap the gender? Like, oh, what the fucking band. Shit?
Yeah, it's like one of these classic YouTube he channels said, where there's Darwin, you grow up, would you quirky be the idol with a green broken. Screen in front of some fucked up backdrops.
Yeah. Oh, right. Yeah, it's creepy. The angle is like super strange. Like it's sort of like she's being shot a little bit from above. It's sort of making her look very small.
Yeah.
And then the visuals are like right now we're in a drone shot over like a church and cemetery in England. Like a war-torn cityscape.
There was like a dystopian, like CGI flaming yeah. city a second ago.
Now she's just sort of. Jesus Christ, this is fucking amazing.
So good. This goes to a beautiful sunset of a New
yeah,
York.
Yeah, that's it, yeah.
Oh, now she's on the subway.
I guess she's going into the city, okay.
Yeah, she fucking rules. She covers everything.
Which is incredible.
Anna Ramel.
This is like one of those things where, like, I don't even know how you make a video like this.
I know.
And then, so it goes from, like, her being beside the subway to, like, a top-down shot of the city. And that was, like, riot footage.
It's so good.
Wow. Oh, yeah, so people throwing Molotov cocktails at buses and stuff.
Hell yeah. Get it. Take back the
home.
Okay, you got CGI driving.
This is like worth mentioning. I mean, you'll share some of these on socials, but also all these notes do go on our Discord. And this is something that everyone should see. This is like so visually unsettling. Every 2 seconds, something fucked is happening. And when you're gone, we want you. She's also moving positions and like sizes.
So good. Anna Ramel is so cool. This is also uploaded in February of this year.
Oh, she's really.
I forgot to mention the best part. The description of the video. Joel verse 2:28, King James Version. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. The Black Parade by My Chemical Romance requested on TikTok.
Yes. Well, she does say a clip of this song went viral on my TikTok, so.
Good. She yeah. rocks.
TikTok, the wheat rises. She looks so happy, too.
Yeah, she's killing it.
Big smile the whole time, even when she's in front of, like, riot footage.
I wonder where she sources her video footage for the. I hope she's paying the appropriate licenses for all the stock she's using.
Now she's like it's like an abstract.
So that's Anna. I thought we could just say goodbye to the song. Say goodbye to MCRch with this wonderful harp cover. It seems to be happening. Also, maybe in a church.
I recently, I went to a performing arts high school, and there was a woman in my grade who played harp. She's the only harpist. She was like very punk, very metal, but she like played harp, and I was like, oh, that's crazy. And recently I was reminiscing about this with a friend from high school, and discovered that she went to jail for heinous sexually related crimes.
Oh,
and,
my God.
Now I just can't hear the harp the same way.
All right, well, then I'm skipping this one because you've ruined it.
I'm sorry. You got one of the else?
With the medieval style.
Oh, there we go.
Bardcore cover. You know what? This has felt like an incredibly long month, and I'm not. It might just be because I've had COVID-19.
Converted half of it.
It might be because we've had to pile up episodes, and we did Mama Na 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 last week, and it just felt like
episodes. We did that like that was 5 days ago.
It just feels like I'm losing my fucking mind with My Chemical Romance, and I wouldn't have it any other way. What a great time! God bless you all. Good night. What about you? Any final thoughts?
Oh, yeah. I thought that was a great way to end it.
I know, but then I realized you should say something.
MCRch rocked, man. This was so fun. I wonder what the month of April will have in store for us.
MCR Facts. Welcome to the Black Parade was first performed at the MTV VMAs in 2006, which took place a few days after My Chemical Romance had unveiled their new look with costumes by Colleen Atwood. It ran in Leeds and were famously bottled. Also bottled that year was Brendan Urie. He passed out. Some context for the bottling. At UK festivals in particular, people throw bottles of piss and just about anything they have, empty beer cans, you know, whatever they have, at performers they don't like. Mike M went on after Slayer, hence why they got a pretty bad bottling. I think it's generally considered that they won the crowd around by the end, but anyway, they said they would never play Red and Leeds again unless they headlined. They got invited back to headline in 2011, and I'm pretty sure Brian May came out for Welcome to the Black Parade. Following the VMAs, the studio version of the song debuted on MySpace a couple of days later, but it would be another 4 weeks before the video dropped and it was officially a single. The video was directed by Samuel Beer, worked with Green Day, and I think there was a bit of contention around him doing the Wake Me Up When September Ends video at the same. You'd have to check that. So Gerard cleared it with Billy Joel. You'd have to Google this to make sure. This is just all off the top of my head. The video for Famous Last Words was shot consecutively, and the float from the Black Parade was set alight in the Famous Last Words video, during which Gerard tore a muscle in his foot and leg being tackled by Frank. Ray fractured his hand, and Bob sustained second and third degree burns from the pyro that led to gangrene. So pretty cursed. The recording of the album, they believe to be cursed as well. They finished writing the album at the Paramore Mansion at the Canfield Marino Estate, which is a Mediterranean villa that has, you can Google it, but there's a lot of history to do with alleged hauntings from it being like an orphanage and a nunnery. It was in Scream 3. It was in the Creature of the from the Black Lagoon from the 20s as well. Gerard went into sort of a trance-like state and covered his walls of his room with loads of stuff, and Mikey famously slipped into a pretty deep depression and immense anxiety and had to leave the writing process. Again, you can read about all of this. But yeah, it's believed to be cursed. The actual track, Welcome to the Black Parade, there were 167 individual tracks on the song, and the guitar solo was actually taken from the demo, which was just an SM58 recording a Marshall practice amp. MCR facts.
We are joined now by Cassie Whitt, a.k.a. Cassie the Venomous. Do you have any other nicknames, actually? Should we do any other a.k.a.s for you?
I have all of my handles are poison and fire.
Okay, so a.k.a. poison and fire, a.k.a. the patron saint of MCR fandom, which is a title bestowed on you by the Chemical Fancast. Tell me about being the patron saint of MCR fandom. What does it mean to be a saint to you?
Oh my goodness. Well, I certainly don't think that I'm a saint, but the folks over at Chemical Fancast are amazing. Kat and Haley are fantastic people, and they give me way too much credit. But I think that the why they've sort of bestowed that upon me is just the fact that this band changed my life. So I came into the fan base like, I'm going to pay this band back somehow. Mm-hmm. And I've kept archives, and I try to put all the right information out there, keep their legacy nice and tidy as if I can. It's getting a little out of control online now, but yeah. And I try to take care of fans as much as I can and help them and guide them. So I think that's kind of where that comes from.
So were you like a part of any other fandoms kind of previously where there was a saint such as yourself kind of doing that work and kind of guiding things? Like, I guess, who are you kind of modeling that work off of when you work on archives, when you sort of, you know, tend to the fandom as you do with MCR?
Yeah, so actually there was a woman named Anna who ran this website called The Immortality Project. It was a My Chemical Romance fan site, and she had all of the magazine scans there. She had bootlegs from like every show. She hosted like fan content, all of their photo shoots. Basically, if you went to that website, you could download just about anything. In fact, I have a funny story. There's a unreleased song MCR did called Sister to Sleep, and she hosted the MP3 there. And so anyone who was familiar with the Immortality Project back then had a download of it. In 2011, I met up with the band at one of their shows, and I was talking about this song. I was like, hey, like, what can you tell me about this song? Mm-hmm. And I was like, is there like a recorded version of it like lost somewhere? And they're like, no, like we did this live version, and that's the only file that exists. I actually don't have it anymore, Frank told me. And I was like, I have it. So I ended up supplying MCR one of their own songs, all thanks to the Immortality Project, this amazing fan site that no longer exists, unfortunately.
That's wild. So he didn't have a copy of the song, and you were able to supply him. You were like, don't worry, I've got the goods.
Yeah. And
I assume they were like, is there any, sometimes like you hear, I don't know, dispiriting stories, but you know, bands being really proprietary about that stuff. But it sounds like he was just sort of stoked to have it. He wasn't like, why is this MP3 circulating around the internet without my, you know, approval?
Oh my gosh. No. So Frank, the guitarist, Frank Ayero, the one who I sent the file to, the one who said he didn't have it, is actually, it's funny because he joined the band and he was like My Chemical Romance's biggest fan at the time, and they needed a second guitarist, and he was like, pick me, oh my god. So if there's anyone who's actually a patron saint of fandom, it's Frank himself. Like, he's
amazing,
biggest fan. Yeah,
that rules. So I mean I told you when we were messaging about you coming on this show that, you know, we had talked to a few people about the band. We were talking to some artists. We're also talking to, kind of for the first time doing episodes like this, people who have this like very specific kind of fan relationship to the band. We spoke earlier with Karen Cunningham, who was doing kind of fan art projects, kind of unlicensed merch, and now is doing actual merch for them. It feels like My Chemical Romance from the outside, because I'm like familiar with the big tunes, but like not deeply, it's not like deeply ingrained in me. And so it feels like there's this unique relationship with like a very, very active fandom where like you're supplying them with MP3s. Karen is now making their official artwork. Like, do you feel like in this, the particular kind of musical universe that MCR exists in, there is a unique kind of fan artist relationship as compared to, I mean, I know you mentioned you work for Alternative Press, like some of the other bands that kind of exist in the same milieu?
It's an interesting question. No one's ever asked me that. I think it's unique in that a lot of people definitely have this parasocial relationship to My Chemical Romance, where they feel like they know them, they relate to them because the songs are so relatable and the band members themselves have been so transparent about their own histories and stories and struggles. So it's easy to feel like, well, like we're the same, you know, we're on the same level, despite the fact that, you know, these millions and millions of fans My Chemical Romance has, everyone kind of feels like there's something personal about the music for every single person. They built an entire world that you can live inside of and cultivate yourself. And so there is this really strong connection. Back in the day, it was definitely, they would like do things for fans. Like they would acknowledge things and they would, you know, shout out those people. So like what Karen's doing now is not necessarily out of the ordinary. I've seen it happen with a few people that I know. But yeah. They're not quite as social anymore, and I guess that's because they've been gone for years and they're back now.
Yeah.
But like Gerard's been known to like scout fan art and bring people in, and they seem to actually kind of have a beat on what's going on and like a pulse on people, even if it's very distant.
No, I mean, it does feel really unique. And I mean, I'm curious then how you go, like, describe your kind of relationship with the band from like hearing them for the first time to swapping MP3s with Frank. Like, what is that journey for you?
Oh man, it's a wild one. And no one's ever really asked me about this. And for a while, people were really mean online. So I like wouldn't tell people like I got to meet them or anything like that. But
really? Like, like people were mean, like who, like other were like just jealous other fans. This is what do you mean?
Yeah, like other fans would literally bully me for going to multiple shows and be mad at me that I met the band. And it was like harsh for a while around like 2008-ish to 2011. Yeah, it sucks. And I used to like archive every show and write reviews for every show, but people started to get mean about it and I started sharing less and less. But I think people are a little more chill now. I think some of those people are gone, which is great for me.
Perfect. Yeah, that's it. You just got to wait for the losers to retire. That's all.
Yeah, yeah, the bullies. You got to get the bullies out.
Totally.
So basically, I started listening to My Chemical Romance in 2004 because of a commercial for Three Cheers for Sweet Revenge, actually. It had snippets from the original I'm Not Okay video where they're driving around on in their van and they're playing show. And there's this one shot of Gerard, and I always reference it when I'm telling people how I got into them, but he's like looking out the window and he just kind of looks, can I swear
or not? You can swear. It's a podcast. Go fucking crazy.
All right. All right. He just looks fucking miserable. And I remember being 14 years old and looking at him and being like, damn, I feel that, you know, it was early mental illness, starting to feel this kind of hopelessness. And then I found this thing where I'm like, oh, like, I feel like this band understands me. And in that video, they also displayed a lot of the hardcore fan culture. And I just kind of knew, like, I am going to be a part of this. And it felt really big. And it felt like I was joining a movement or something. It was like more than a band. They've always been more than a band. But yeah, the first song I heard was I'm Not Okay, I Promise. And then Helena through someone's burnt CD that they played me on a school bus field trip.
Yes.
And then it kind of went out of order. I ended up downloading Bullets from Bandcamp, I think, or something else. But yeah, anyway, so it was from 14 years old on. And the first time I met them, I actually had a heat stroke at Warped Tour. And
classic, the classic move for sure. Yeah. Everyone's been there.
Yeah. So security like grabbed me out of the crowd. And I think it was kind of like hint, hint, nudge, nudge. I see how excited you are about this band. I'm going to take you backstage because it was after their set. I was like sweating, panting, about to pass out. And I jumped up and I grabbed for the security guard. I'm like, hey, can you help me out? And he lifted me over the barrier and I started to walk away and I like stumbled and he was like, nope, you're coming with me to first aid. And he took me literally under the stage MCR had just played and they're standing there like on the other side. I just see their asses and like Gerard holding a cigarette. And I was like losing my mind. I probably really did have a heat stroke, you know?
So yeah, there's a few things happening there.
Right. There was a lot happening. And I just remember falling, first of all, when I got out from under the stage, like right onto one of their loading ramps and like cutting my leg on, I'm pretty sure it was like the side of a drum stand. So I'm always like proud, like, hey, I have a piece of MCR's drum in my knee.
This is a real, like, this is an intense meet cute for sure.
And I just like, I didn't know what to say. And they were like walking away. And I was like, oh no, they're walking away. I'm losing them. And I just go, Gerard. And they all kind of turn around and are like, oh shit, this lunatic. So I go to the first aid tent and they're standing like 20 feet away in a circle talking. And I'm just sitting there like staring at them. Like, oh my God, they are so close to me. And it ended up that Mikey walked by and I met Mikey. And then Gerard walked by as well and I met him. And then sort of after that, it was one of the first dates on Warped Tour 2005. They started realizing like, hey, kids are getting hurt out there. And they would actually pop by the first aid tent and say hello to fans. After
really that, like that became a thing that they did, is they would just visit the first aid tent after their sets.
Yeah
That fucking totally. Rules.
Yeah, they're amazing people, like unbelievable people. And then kind of from there, like I met them several more times, just kind of through meet and greets and stuff through the MC Army. The MC Army was their street team, and basically folks from Warner Brothers ran it, and they took notice of, you know, people who were doing like a lot of stuff, and they afforded them really cool opportunities. So I sort of kept running into them until it was like, oh, Cassie. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Until you were like a known quantity. Yeah.
Yeah. And then in 2010 is when things kind of got really crazy, because Danger Days was coming out and Mikkel Mossberg, who worked at Warner Brothers at the time and was the admin for the street team, was like, he would kind of like nudge me and let me know when things were about to happen. And he was like, hey, I have a question. Would you fly out to California and listen to the album? And I was like, what?
No, I'm good. I'm busy.
Yeah, right.
Thanks.
Oh, there's a plane going by.
Look at love that people are traveling, you know? It's just nice to be reminded.
Right.
So they offered appropriately enough, like that was sort of like in situ audio, like plane style, they offered to fly you out to California.
Right, exactly. Yeah, I was sitting in a music or rock and roll, history of rock and roll class in college, and I got this text, and I just bolted out of the room because like there was going to be no learning done for the rest of that class. So Warner Brothers flew me out to this fan exclusive listening party. A couple people came with me. There was a woman named Brandy who I nominated for the opportunity. She ran a fan site called My Chemical Freak, I believe, or Chemical Freak. And then another person that I went really way back with from the MC Army street team, Irene, was there. Like, it was just a really cool experience. They sat us down. First of all, I got a hotel and flights there and back. Thanks, Warner Brothers.
Yeah, that's sick.
And they brought us all in and we got like some little swag things, like some wristbands and t-shirts and stuff. And we all sat and we listened to the album. And then we got to review it and get like reposted on the website. And that was something that they really began doing for the World Contamination Danger Days tour, was having these sort of fan guest bloggers. So just because they knew me and they knew that I would like take it seriously and do it for every show that I went to on that tour, they let me be the correspondent. So I got photo pit passes, and I got to write about the show, and it was awesome. And I got to meet the band before the show at both of those shows, and it was just kind of great. And through that, I met their then manager, Lauren Valencia. Unfortunately, she recently passed away. She was a beautiful person, really lovely, and cared about fans so much. And she was definitely someone to look up to. She gave me advice going into the music industry. Like, she was just a fantastic soul. And it's very tragic that we lost her at a young age. But she basically, she came to know me. And after that, it was kind of like, you know, any show you want to come to, you're on the guest list, just come. And it just kind of went from there. And, you know, at this point, they like all followed me on Twitter. And it was, I don't know, it's very surreal. Like when I think about it, I think about if I told myself when I was 14, oh, by the way, they're going to know your name someday. I would have, oh my gosh, I would have thought that I was being really mean and playing a terrible joke on me.
Yeah, but that's so fucking sick.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. They honestly have so much respect and care for their fans, and the opportunities that they were able to give me were unbelievable. And then eventually I got to work with them in a professional capacity for alternative press. And one of the most surreal things that happened to me was Gerard, shortly after the band broke up, Gerard came to the office because he was doing an alternate cover of their first issue that they were the cover artist for, and sort of redesigning it and making it more artful. And he came to the office, and my editor then, Jason Pettigrew, who's also a huge MCR fan and one of my like best friends, brought him in and sat him in my office, where I have pictures of his fucking face everywhere.
Yeah.
And he was like cool with, like, he wasn't like weird about it. He was like, oh yeah, that's Cassie, you know.
Yeah, he's probably been in some rooms with pictures of his face.
Yeah, for sure. But yeah, this is kind of a lot. So at the time he was working on Hesitant Alien, his first solo album. I think at the time it was called Baby Animal Hospital. It was like the working title.
That's a sick working title.
Right. And he was like, I want to show you something. And so he had Jason pull up files from the album and play me the demos. And he didn't like, the speakers in my office weren't great, so we went into another office, closed the door. It was just me and Gerard, and I'm listening to his music with him sitting there beside me, like, oh my god, is this really happening?
That's fucking sick. And that is great. What if you didn't like it though? Like, what if you were like, you were like, this actually sucks ass, I'm sorry to say.
Oh my gosh. No.
It didn't happen.
Gerard's brain is just so unbelievable and creative and strange and wonderful that I don't think I could ever dislike something that came out of it.
That's fair.
Wild, you know?
I mean, that is such an incredible journey. And I love, like, you know, cause I think of my own kind of journey professionally, kind of through music and music journalism and everything. And it always starts with like the things that you love. And it can be so intensely gratifying when you get to a point in your career where, like, oh my God, imagine if 16-year-old me could see this. Like, imagine if, and that's such a like a beautiful straight line. And so I love hearing that. Mm-hmm. I'm curious as well, because obviously this has been in particular the last 2 years have been like wild for everyone in the world, but like wild for MCR, because it's like the canceled shows, the like my entire feed. I mean, I've discovered that everyone I know in my life at some point was a massive My Chemical Romance fan based on like what happens with tickets and like tour announcements and tour cancellations. You know, for some context, like over the duration of the pandemic, I worked on a TV show where we talked to different kind of fan groups really about how their lives have changed and their community had changed because of the pandemic. So people who played D&D and sometimes use Zoom Dungeon Masters having to be online all the time, people who made mukbang videos, it turns out I've been pronouncing it wrong my whole life, you know, mm-hmm. what that community was like. I mean, people who were doing like online sex work, same thing, like, you know, how those communities kind of transitioned and adapted and what it meant to have a supportive community during this like historically fucked time for everyone. So I'm curious for you, like over the last 2 years, just the general sort of insane shit that we've all been dealing with, kind of coupled with what has obviously been sort of a tumultuous time a little bit for fans of the band. How has being part of and being the patron saint of this like particular fan of this particular fan community been, I guess, important to surviving the last 2 years, been particularly complicated by the last 2 years? Like, what has that experience been like for you?
It has been stressful.
Yeah, okay, that makes sense.
I kind of, I guess, when the pandemic started, it was so quickly after they had done their return show. And I remember telling people like, okay, I guess we can't have like the good thing. Like MCR being back, like shifted the balance in the universe. So it was too good. So the world had to be like, nah, fuck that. We need to get back to bad, you know?
Yeah, that's it. For every action, et cetera, et cetera.
Right, exactly. They, you know, they give you one, they take it away. It's been an entirely different experience than it was, you know, back in 2010 or whenever, because the fan base has just continued to grow in their absence. There are countless new fans, and there are some people who, with the whole emo nostalgia thing, who are coming out of the woodwork, who maybe back in the day made fun of me for listening to MCR, who are now like, oh yeah, that band rules, you know? And it's crazy because the demand for them is outrageous. Like some of the things that I own that are like not even that limited are going for like $5,000 on eBay. And the ticket situation is insane. And it feels like, wow, like for a very long time, I was like, oh, this is, you know, my little world, you know? And now it feels just very chaotic and huge. And that's not a bad thing. But it definitely makes things like buying tickets or planning things extremely difficult. Basically, it's just, you know, it's crazy how much they've grown when they weren't doing anything.
Maybe there's a lesson in that. It's just like, just chill for like 10 years, come back. Yeah. Everyone will like be excited to see you. Cause yeah, it is like people coming out of the woodwork. And that's funny that, cause my experience is just like, I've never seen certain people on my timeline ever talk about like a punk band or an emo band or whatever category went like before. And all of a sudden it's like an obsession with MCR has sort of is leaking out of their pores. But for you, it's interesting because you're like, yeah, there are people who like made fun of you for being obsessed with this band that are now like have the same porous fandom issue. That's what you gotta smack some people down. You gotta tell people to fuck off, I think. It's just my advice, you know, unsolicited, take it or leave it.
I try not to be too much of a shithead about it, but sometimes I am like, oh man, like you got to go to that show and I didn't. Like,
yeah, it's fair. Now, are you going to be going? Cause I mean, there was the recent announce with, again, tickets, like an unbelievably stacked list of openers. So will you be going to some MCR shows in the year of our Lord 2022, 2023?
As long as COVID behaves itself, I will. Originally,
I'm knocking here for you.
Thank you. Originally, my first shows back were supposed to be the Milton Keynes England shows, which were originally some of the first shows. But unfortunately, things changed over the past couple of years. I had to sell my tickets, but I will be seeing them in the States. I'll see them in Cincinnati, Detroit, Philadelphia, at that huge When We Were Young festival, and at Riot Fest.
So, okay, so that's pretty fulsome. So you got some MCR coming up in your life.
I do. I am very fortunate that I was able to get those tickets.
Amazing. Well, Cassie, I really appreciate your time. For people who want to follow you both for like the professional work that you do, I mean, we didn't really even talk about, you know, your writing, but you obviously are you know, you write, you do video, but you are also the patron saint of MCR fandom. Where can people find you? And is there anything else that you should or would like to promote in this, the hallowed promotional spot on a pump podcast?
You can find me on Instagram and Twitter. That's where I'm the most active, at Poison and Fire. And no, I don't think I have anything that I need to promote right now, but oh, I am working on an article right now for Alternative Press, where I'm archiving some of the most rare MCR artifacts. So keep a lookout for that, I suppose.
Sick. Thank you, Cassie.
Yeah, thank you.
This is a reading about the production of The Black Parade by Tom Bryant. Gerard would struggle to sleep and would go on to suffer what he called night terrors, in which he said it felt as though someone was gripping his throat and squashing his lungs. He used it as inspiration for the song Sleep, written in the studio around the same time as Famous Last Words, but it pointed to the intensity of the experience. He became obsessed with Joan of Arc and considered shaving his head as she had once done. He bought countless films about her and watched them alone in his room, prepped in nightmares in which he watched her burning alive. It was a mentally difficult process to go through, and this was just the writing stage. There was one evening in particular that it began to get too much for Gerard. He wandered outside on the estate, a cigarette burning in his hand and turmoil blaring in his head. He stared out at Los Angeles below him, a million twinkling lights, a vast city of different people leading different lives, and he felt completely lost. "I was wondering what the hell I was doing with my life," he said of that moment. "I was examining every awful thing about myself. I was cutting myself open, taking all the parts out and examining them. It was like an operating room. Every day we were finding something new and ugly that we didn't like about ourselves. We found all the cracks, we found all the chinks in our armor, and it made us realize, wow, I'm not a likable person. I found out that I was a coward. I found out all these things about myself." Such was Gerard's state of mind. Mikey began to wonder if his brother was going through a collapse. During the course of the recording, he and Gerard would make reference to the Smashing Pumpkins' classic double album, Melancholy and Infinite Sadness, but in a darkly self-referential manner. "I went through a crisis," said Gerard. Mikey called it a pre-midlife crisis. He actually refers to the record as pre-midlife crisis in the Infinite Sadness. "I went through a very weird thing. We were in the middle of making this record and it was a crisis. The thing is, he was far from the only member of the band to feel like he was losing his mind."
The Complaint Department. 155 podcast.
The Complaint Department. 155 podcast.
The Complaint Department. 155 podcast.
This complaint is directed at Sam. A few episodes back, Sam mentioned something off the cuff about a Fall Out Boy song. In classic pod style, it looks like some people, not going to name names, some people took it upon themselves to make Sam's comment into a reality. This was posted on the Discord, and it just seems like it's been completely ignored. Some people just worked really hard to provide Sam with something that he wanted. And it's been a few weeks now, and it's just been ignored. You know, and I just got to complain about that. Oh, and happy birthday, Sam.
Yeah, sorry about that, Stephen. I don't know what happened. We just kind of had so many complaints this month to kind of get lost in the shuffle.
Yeah, I mean, Josiah just didn't want me to get my birthday wishes. So thank you to you, and no thanks to the you know, birthday hoarder, Josiah Hughes.
And the other thing you're talking about, no fucking clue, but yeah, you know, all the best to you. And
thank you. I mean, it's not like I that's good. And I apologize.
All right, goodbye.